إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليما كثيرا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله. Indeed, the most truthful of speech is the book of Allah. وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the best guidance is the guidance of our beloved messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. وشر الأمور محدثاتها. And the worst of affairs are those things we newly invent into this religion of ours. وَكُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ. And everything we newly invent into this religion of ours is an innovation. وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ. And every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray. وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. Every going astray, every misguidance is in the hellfire. ثُمَّ أَمَّا بَعْدٍ. My dear brothers in Islam, as we spoke the last couple of weeks about seeking to do the righteous deeds, we're reminded with the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ how some few actions could make all of those good deeds be scattered like dust and be worth nothing for you. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أتدرون من المفلس؟ قالوا المفلس فينا يا رسول الله من لا درهم له ولا متاع. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم المفلس من أمتي من يأتي يوم القيامة بصلاته وصيامه وزكاته ويأتي قد شتم هذا وقذف هذا وأكل مال هذا وسفك دم هذا وضرب هذا فيقتص هذا من حسناته وهذا من حسناته، فإن فنيت حسناته قبل أن يقتص ما عليه من الخطايا أخذ من خطاياهم فطرح عليه ثم طرح في النار. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, in this authentic hadith in the Sunan of al-Tirmidhi, and you also find it similarly in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, he asked the companions, do you know who is the muflis, who is the one who's bankrupt? So the companion said, the bankrupt one who is the one who has no money and has no property. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, the bankrupt one in my ummah is not the one who's poor in money or wealth or land or ownership. The bankrupt in my ummah is the one who comes on the day of resurrection with his prayers, with his fasting, with his zakat. But they also come that day having abused this one, falsely accusing this one, wrongfully consuming the wealth of this one, spilling the blood of that one, beating this one. So he is seated. He will be seated. And then the people who he wronged will come and it will be said to them to take the hasanat, take the good deeds of this person who wronged you. And if he runs out of hasanat, then it will be told, give them some of your sins for what they did to you, and then they will be taken to the hellfire. Our notion, my brothers in Islam, is that bankruptcy means no wealth, no richness of the worldly life. And this is what we always think of it. Allah says, وَأُحْضِرَتْ الْأَنفُسُ الشُّحَّ وَإِنْ تُحْسِنُوا وَتَتَّقُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرًا. And Allah says what means, and humans, their inner selves are swayed by greed. But if you do good and you keep away from evil, verily Allah is ever acquainted with what you do. So we humans by that nature have that greed, always wanting. Things are never enough for us. We're never satisfied with what Allah gives us. The hadith continues, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم المفلس من أمتي من يأتي يوم القيامة بصلاته وصيامه وزكاته. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that the one from my ummah will come on the day of resurrection with his salah and his siyam and his zakat. So the Prophet ﷺ, he clarified that bankruptcy is not about rich or wealth, being rich or wealthy. So the bankrupt one is the one who comes with salah. The first thing we will be asked about on the day of resurrection. The one that the Prophet ﷺ, he said, who abandons the salah, فَمَنْ تَرَكَهَا فَقَدْ كَفَرْ. Whoever leaves off the prayer has committed kufr. The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that also shows the value of that salah, where he said, بَيْنَ الرَّجُلُ وَبَيْنَ الْكُفْرِ وَالشِّرْكِ تَرْكُ الصَّلَاةِ. That between a man and being a mushrik, a polytheist, or a kafir, a disbeliever, is their abandoning the prayer. Also from the hadith of Mu'ad ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu, where he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, رَأْسُ الْأَمْرِ الْإِسْلَامُ عَمُودُهُ الصَّلَاةِ. That the head matter with us Muslims is Islam as our deen. And its pillar, the pillar of al-Islam, is the prayer itself. It was narrated that Abdullah, he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أول ما يحاسب به العبد الصلاة وأول ما يقضى بين الناس في الدماء. That the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the authentic hadith in the Sunan of An-Nisa'i, that the first thing a person will be judged or brought to account for on the day of resurrection will be their salah, their prayers. And the first thing concerning which scores will be settled between the people will be those who shed blood. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned they will come with siyamihi, he will come with his fasting. That fasting that we know it is a deed only done for Allah. As we have in the hadith Qudsi, where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam narrated, he said, قال الله عز وجل كل عمل ابن آدم له إلا الصيام فإنه لي وأنا أجزي به والصيام جنة. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Allah, the Exalted and Majestic, said, every act of the son of Adam is for him except for the fasting. It is for me. It is the thing that he can truly do or she can truly do, and it is solely for me, and I will reward them for it. And fasting is a shield. So they come now with the salah. They come with their fasting, which is only for Allah, and he'll reward for it. And it is a shield from the hellfire. And they will come paying their zakat, knowing that the sin of the one who does not pay it is a grievous punishment on the day of resurrection. And it is very serious. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من آتاه الله مالا فلم يؤدي زكاته مثل له ماله شجاعا أقرأ له زبيبتان يوم القيامة يتوقه يوم القيامة يأخذ بلهزميه يعني بشدقيه يقول أنا مالك أنا كنزك ثم تلا هذه الآية ولا يحسبن الذين يبخلون بما آتاهم الله من فضله إلى آخر الآية. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he clarified the punishment of the one who doesn't give his zakat al-mal, saying anyone who has given his wealth, anyone who Allah has given wealth, afwan, but he does not pay zakat on it, then on the day of resurrection, his wealth will be made into a bald-headed, poisonous snake with two poisonous glands, and it will encircle itself around the neck and bite the cheeks of the one who didn't pay the zakat and say, أنا مالك أنا كنزك. I am your wealth, I am your treasure. Then the Prophet ﷺ, he recited the ayah, and let not those who covetously withhold of that which Allah has bestowed upon them of his bounty. So now, you have the one who came with the prayers, knowing that's the first thing you'll be asked about. The one who comes with the siyam, knowing that it's for Allah and Allah rewards for it and it's a shield from the fire. And he comes paying the zakat, so he's freed from this punishment on the day of resurrection. But وَيَأْتِي قَدْ شَتَمَ هَذَا. But he comes on the day of resurrection also having abused this one verbally, cursing this one verbally, backbiting and slandering others, reviling and insulting others. How often do we see this? How often do we see this? And what you should know is that when you're doing that, you may be insulting someone and getting the upper edge on them and making them angry and getting revenge towards them. But all you're doing is making your good worldly deeds of salah, siyam, zakat worthless and meaningless, having no weight. At-Tirmidhi, he related on the authority of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَيْسَ الْمُؤْمِنْ بِالطَّعَانِ وَلَا اللَّعَانُ وَلَا الْفَاحِشْ وَلَا الْبَغِيْءِ. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the believer is not one who insults or slanders, And the believer is not one who curses others. And the believer is not one who is immoral or vulgar. And the believer is not one who is shameless. And this hadith is related by at-Tirmidhi. And he graded it as Hasan, al-Hakim graded it as Sahih. Al-Darqutni, he said that it is most probably mawquf, and Sheikh al-Albani, he authenticated it. The believer does not have these traits where they insult and they curse and they're immoral and they're vulgar and they have no shame. Allah says, وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسُكُمْ وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ بِئْسَ الْإِسْمُ الْفُسُوقُ بَعْدَ الْإِيمَانِ. Allah says what means in Surah Al-Hujurat, do not defame one another, do not insult one another, do not abuse one another, do not call one another by names. How bad is it to insult one's brother after having faith? Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he mentioned that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَتَدْرُونَ مَا الْغِيبَ. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked his companions, do you know what is ghiba, what is backbiting? قَالُوا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَعْلَمُ. They said, Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam know best. قَالَ ذِكْرُكَ أَخَاكَ بِمَا يَكْرَهُ قِيلَ أَفَرَأَيْتَ إِنْ كَانَ فِي أَخِيهِ مَا أَقُولُ قَالَ إِنْ كَانَ فِيهِ مَا تَقُولُ فَقَدْ اِخْتَبْتَهُ وَإِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ فِيهِ فَقَدْ بَهَدْتَهُ. This authentic hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, do you know what is backbiting? And his companion said, Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam know best. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, it is to say, backbiting implies that you say something about your brother in a manner which he does not like. It was said to him, what if what I'm saying is the truth about him? I'm not lying, I'm not making it up. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, if that failing is actually found in him, if that thing you're mentioning about him is actually found in him and he does it, then this is backbiting and you have backbitten him. And if it's not in him, then you are lying and this is slander. And this hadith is in the Sahih of Muslim. So these things can make all of our deeds, the fara'id, which we've mentioned the last 2 weeks, from the deeds that Allah loves and you draw near to Allah with, they can become worthless and meaningless. وَقَذَفَ هَذَا. They falsely accuse others. Usually it's about being unchaste, something that comes back again. And for that matter, falsely accusing anybody of anything, then this comes under slander. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn Rabi'ah, he narrated, I witnessed at the time of Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman radiallahu anhum, and those who came after them, I never saw them flogging someone who was accused of, or who was proven to have committed qadhaf, a false accusation of adultery, except with 40 lashes. This was the penalty to falsely accuse. And nowadays, as we see the family units breaking up and fights between husbands and wife being the topic of every day, وَالْعَيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, a lot of times there's this false accusation and you are committing a great crime that in the time of the companions you used to get lashed 40 times with. Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِّنَ الظَّنِّ إِنَّ بَعْضَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٌ وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَوَّابٌ رَّحِيمٌ. Allah says also in Surah Al-Hujurat, what means, O you who believe, avoid much suspicion, because indeed some suspicion is haram, it is sinful. And spy not, nor backbite, nor slander, a direct command from our Lord. And the first thing you do when you commit this qadhaf, this false accusation, is all of these things. And fear Allah, afwan, would one of you like to eat the flesh of his dead brother? None of us would think to do such a thing. Even if we were starving out in the middle of nowhere and all we had was the flesh of another human, we wouldn't do it. Because of the filth of it and the sickness that it brings to our minds and our bodies. You would hate it, so hate backbiting and fear Allah. Verily, Allah is the one who accepts repentance. وَأَكَلَ مَا لَهَذَا. The Prophet ﷺ then moved on to say, you can come with prayers, come with fasting, come with the zakat, but if you consume the wealth wrongfully of another person, it can make all of your prayers and fasting and zakat go to waste, and you'll have nothing from it. وَتَأْكُلُونَ التُّرَاثَ أَكْلًا لَمَّا. And Allah said what means, and you consume the inheritance, devouring it altogether. تِلْكَ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ. Allah has limits set by Allah. Inheritance, the mirath, is one of those limits set by Allah. We don't need your opinion. We don't need your feelings. We don't need your decision or your ideas on how to split the wealth of someone who passes away. Allah revealed it in his book, and his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam affirmed it. And there's cases every day where people steal the inheritance of others, especially the wealth of their sisters or their daughters or their mothers or anyone that they fall in these, or their wives, saying, oh, she is married, or oh, she's well taken care of, or oh, she has too many sons, or oh, her son is a doctor and can support her. So they think this gives them the legitimacy to overturn the book of Allah and the sunnah of his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and consume wrongfully and steal that wealth. وَأَكَلَ مَالَهَا, that this falls under this category. This is sirqa, this is stealing. And our messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, وَلَا يَسْرِقُ حِينَ يَسْرِقُ وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ. And the one who steals, he or she is not a believer at the time of their stealing. So fear Allah with respect to this. Just again, desiring this dunya, wanting wealth, whether you get it good, the right way or the wrong way, whether you get it in a halal way or haram way, whether you steal the inheritance of someone who you think is well off, it is all going to make your deeds become nothing and distance you from Allah's mercy. وَسَفَكَ دَمَّ هَذَا, and the spilling of the blood of this person and that person. قَالَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِنَّ أَوَّلَ مَا يُحْكَمُ بِهِ إن أول ما يحكم بين العباد في الدماء رواه الترمذي. This hadith is sahih. In the Sunan of al-Tirmidhi, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, indeed, the first cases to be judged between the people on the day of resurrection are those who shed blood, because it's such an easy case for Allah to decree upon. Allah is the one who gives life, and he is the one who can take that life, unless there is significant straight up cause, and you're in an Islamic environment which follows the Quran and the Sunnah, then this is for the government authorities to take out at those times. And there's a similar narration with different words in Bukhari and Muslim. And lastly, the Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned وَضَرَبَ هَذَا, and the beating of this one or that one, striking people without any right, heavy-handed, easily, you physically abuse others, you hit them to intimidate them, and you do so in a way, this only burns up the fara'id and the good deeds that's supposed to get you nearer to Allah. My brothers in Islam, we can come to Allah with the prayers and the fasting and the good deeds, but let us not burn them by the sins that we could do, wronging the rights of the people. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا أَسْتَغْفِرَ اللَّهِ وَلَكُمْ أَدْعُ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبُكُمْ. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا وبعد. So my dear brothers in Islam, we have this beautiful hadith where the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أتدرون من المفلس, who, do you know who is the bankrupt one? And of course the companions, they responded with, it is the one who doesn't have any wealth or property. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he clarified to us who these are, and we will wrap the hadith up at the end to remind us with it. But the end of the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, فَيَقْعُدُ فَيَقْتَصُ هَذَا مِنْ حَسَنَاتِهِ وَهَذَا مِنْ حَسَنَاتِهِ فَإِنْ فَنِيَتْ حَسَنَاتُهُ قَبْلَ أَنْ يُقْتَصَ مَا عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْخَطَايَا أُخِذَ مِنْ خَطَايَاهُمْ فَطُرِحَ عَلَيْهِ ثُمَّ طُرِحَ فِي النَّارِ. So the Messenger of Allah ﷺ, he said, so this one who came with prayers and fasting and zakat, but he made them all become vanished because of his deeds, he will be seated, and this one will be requited from his rewards. The ones he wronged will be called to say, come and take from his rewards, until he has no rewards. And if he runs out of rewards, they'll be said, okay, they'll be told, give him some of your sins, until this person will be cast into the fire. My brothers in Islam, do not render your good deeds, your obligatory acts of worship, like your prayers and your fasting and your zakat, do not render them void. These are obligatory actions of worship, from the most beloved deeds to Allah, from the salah to the siyam to the zakat. وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا افْتَرَدْتُهُ عَلَيْهِ. And my servant, as we've mentioned the last couple of weeks in the Hadith Qudsi, Allah said, and my servant does not draw near to me with anything more loved to me than the religious duties I made obligatory upon him. So imagine that life, spent fasting, spent praying, spent paying your zakat, And you come on the day of resurrection doing these deeds to draw you near to Allah, deeds that Allah loves, but they all become worthless and you go to the hellfire. Why? Because you rendered them void and brought no benefit to yourself with them, because you abused people verbally and you falsely accused others, especially with respect to their chastity, and you wrongly consumed and stole the wealth of others, and you spilled the blood of others, and you beat others. So let us take heed, my brothers in Islam, of these warnings and not be of those who are bankrupt in the sight of Allah, despite the amount of dollars and cents we put to our name in this dunya. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أُولَئِكَ هُمْ خَيْرُ الْبَرِيَّةِ. Verily, those who believe in the oneness of Allah, and they believe and follow His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they follow all the obligations ordered by Islam, and they do righteous deeds, they are the best of men, they are the best of creatures. May Allah make us from them. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك أنت سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات. يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من البرص والجنون والجذام ومن سيء الأسقام. يا أرحم الراحمين. سبحان ربك رب العزة أما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.